Hi folks, Canadian Prepper here. So today I'm going to be doing a review of my 2016 Toyota Tacoma. And I promise you that it's not always this clean. Normally it's actually quite dirty because for the last 2 years, I've taken this thing everywhere. Mountainous terrain, snow, very icy terrain, mud, water. I've taken it and put it through the test in the back roads. I wouldn't say I necessarily was rock crawling in the desert or anything like that, but I've put it to the test. So I think, you know, 2 years, 50,000 kilometers in, I think I have enough of a database of experience with the truck that I can give you an honest review. Now, just to clarify, Toyota is in no way affiliated with this review. So I'm going to be telling you the pros and the cons. And would I buy this truck again? So before I get to the actual review of the truck, everybody's always asking about the tonneau cover on the back. It's a Diamondback HD tonneau cover. It's probably one of the strongest, most versatile truck covers on the market. And I say versatile because there are some truck covers which are more heavy duty than that, that some of the guys up here in Canada use for their skidoos and whatnot. But they don't have the versatility in the sense that you can't easily access the truck bed. It's quite the job putting those things on the truck bed, those other ones, and you don't have the different compartments and ways to open it up and all the accessories like the cross bin and the various different compartments that Diamondback provides. So I'm gonna post the link in the description if you're interested in that. Go check it out. Holds 1600 pounds. I've done a lot of reviews on it. I've put quads on there. I've used it for hauling all sorts of stuff. It's a nice way to secure your gear in the truck bed. It's one of the more secure tonneau covers. Obviously nothing's 100% secure, but it's as secure as it gets anyways, as far as tonneau covers go. So that's pretty cool. So in terms of the modifications that I've made to this truck, that's one. I haven't really made any serious modifications yet, but I am in store for a new bumper and winch combo and possibly a light bar as well. That's gonna be next on the list once I can afford it, because that's something that I think, you know, would be quite practical. I don't know how much I'm gonna use a winch, if I'll ever use it, but it'll give me more confidence to go certain places perhaps, and hopefully get me to places I wouldn't normally be able to get to, because I do take this thing down the back road. So this is a 2016 TRD Sport, four-wheel drive, obviously, a double cab. This is the Sport version because I wanted to get the off-road version, but there was such a weight, even just to get a different color in the version. I wanted to get a black in the Sports version. Actually, I originally wanted a black off-road 2016, you know, and I couldn't get that, so I had to settle for the Sport, and I couldn't even get the color I wanted in the Sport. It was gonna be 7 to 8 months just to get a different color of the Sport, much less the off-road version, which usually gets scooped up as soon as they come off the assembly line in Toyota, so very hard to get. And the reason why I wanted to get that, because I'm all about function over fashion. In the off-road version, you get skid plates, you get, what else do you get? You get a locking rear differential, different tires, more aggressive tread on the tires. You don't have that, I just call it a dental dam. I don't know what that thing is on the bottom. Just gives you a better aerodynamics or something like that. So you don't get that. And the only thing you really get with a Sport, you don't get much that's actually functional. You get a hood scoop, which is purely cosmetic. It's not actually functional at all. It doesn't do anything. I know it's kind of stupid. You get one skid plate. I believe the skid plate is on the front, but you don't get a rear skid plate. And you don't have that steep approach. So you have this dental dam on there. And I mean, that's gonna limit your approach angle a little bit, but still it gets the job done. You have a sunroof, and I believe the truck bed is a little bit longer on this one, which is kind of nice actually. So it's a little bit more practical. The suspension is Sport tuned as opposed to off-road tuned. and you don't have as dynamic a control over the crawl control feature. So it really, you know, for the same price, you should always go with the off-road version, in my opinion, if you can get the 6-foot truck bed. I think getting the 6-foot truck bed in the off-road version is pretty rare, especially in the color that you want it, because these trucks, like I say, they sell right off the assembly line. Everybody wants one. So the reason why I got this over a larger truck, a Tundra, was for a few reasons. Gas mileage was a part of it, but you're only saving 10% gas mileage on this over the Toyota Tundra, which is the big brother to this truck. Pulls a lot more, has a heavier payload, but is much wider. It's almost a foot wider. Actually, I think it's more, a little bit more than a foot wider than this truck. So the box is gonna be a lot bigger and it's gonna sit up a lot higher. So you don't get quite the commanding view with the Tacoma. Actually, it feels like when you get into the truck, it feels like you're in an SUV because you're not that high off the ground. But there is some good clearance right out of the box. So much better clearance than, you know, a Jeep Grand Cherokee. Actually, the clearance you get on these is probably equivalent to some of the Wranglers that aren't modified. So you get good clearance. Everything about the truck is pretty much the same, besides the not locking rear differential and the lack of skid plates. So it's the same truck as the off-road. It's just doesn't have some of those more rugged durability enhancing features. So I got it because it's narrow, and the great thing about this truck is that it's so narrow that, and even though it's still a pretty big for a mid-sized truck, it's so narrow that you can actually go down some of the quad roads without totally destroying the side of your truck. I use it for that purpose. I wanted something which could navigate those tertiary, quaternary back roads that you can't get down with a big truck, or you could, but you're really gonna damage the side of your truck. And it's easier to park. It's a bit more practical when you're driving around the city. And you gotta think of practical things like that as well, because it's not all about like prepping for SHTF. I mean, 99% of the time, you're gonna be stuck with the vehicle that you choose. And for me, I didn't want just a bug out vehicle. And you know, I may at some point invest some time and resources into a vehicle just for that purpose and for the purpose of, you know, doing some off-roading and stuff like that. But for the time being, I want something that I can use. You know, I'm running the CanadianPreparedness.com business now, so I basically need a truck. Being a homeowner, quote unquote, or a borrower from the bank, there's a lot of tasks that come along with that that really, it benefits having a truck for that purpose. That's why I made the leap from an SUV. And I think if you are making a leap to a truck from an SUV, going with a midsize like this is a nice crossover, because that might just be too much truck for somebody. And if you were, you know, if you had a Jeep or something like that, or an SUV for a long time, then chances are you maybe don't need, unless you're changing occupations or, you know, whatever the case might be, you might not need to make that jump to a full size truck, unless you want to pull like, you know, a very large trailer or something like that. I think it's a good transition vehicle for me, because my next vehicle likely will be a much bigger truck. And the reason why is because of family. I wasn't really thinking when I first got this truck. My kids were really young. They were still babies, so they were in, you know, baby seats. And now they're getting a little bit bigger. And then of course we got a dog, and you know, it's just not big enough to fit the entire family in it. So it's problematic for that purpose. So I wouldn't recommend this truck if you are, you know, a family person. If the majority of the time you're gonna spend in the vehicle alone, then this is a good truck for that. This is a good weekend warrior truck. It's basically, in a lot of ways, it is like an SUV in terms of its capabilities. I mean, it has very similar suspension as the Toyota Land Cruiser. So this thing, in terms of off-road, the reason why I went with Toyota is because they're just built to last. Everybody knows that Toyota is renowned for the longevity of their vehicles. And the resale value is another thing. There's trucks with over 100,000 kilometers reselling for over $30,000 Tacomas from years ago. So, you know, they have a great resale value. They hold their value much better than any other truck on the market. And they're very reliable. I haven't had any issues with it whatsoever. And I mean, I know I've only driven it 50,000 K, but You know, I haven't been exactly nice to it. This one time I drove into the ditch and went over some pretty aggressive bumps, but that suspension is just excellent, man. So there's a few other minor cosmetic things. There's a rock deflector there. There's some streamlining. I'm not sure what they're called, but they're just these little things that add to the aerodynamics of the vehicle. So I also did the front grille because I didn't really like the grille that came with it. It just looked very feminine, to be honest. It didn't match the capabilities of the vehicle. It was like putting a bunch of lipstick on a UFC fighter. It just didn't seem right to me. So I changed it out with the grille, which matches the TRD Pro. Not because I'm trying to masquerade this truck as a TRD Pro 2017 vehicle, but because I just like the look of the grille. I think it's one of the best looking grills that you can get. So you can get other cheaper ones, but for me personally, you know, that's the grille that I wanted on there because it just looks more aggressive, more ballsy, and it's All American Prepper approved. So it's good for that purpose. It's probably gonna get covered up a little bit if I put some bull bars on there and a winch bumper, but I'm gonna try to go lightweight on the winch bumper because I don't wanna have too much more weight. I already got the diamond back on there. The payload is about 1,600 pounds, I believe. You never wanna fully max that out. And the towing capacity is 7,200 pounds or possibly 6,800, but I think it's 7,200 pounds. So, but don't quote me on that, go look it up. I probably only ever wanna pull 5,000 maximum, just, you know, I wouldn't want to push the truck too hard, especially if I was traveling. You know, here in the prairies, it's not too bad because there's not a lot of inclines. But if I was heading out west or even out east where it's a bit more hilly and mountainous, then you might not want to be hauling a very large trailer with this thing. What else can I say about it? Another issue that people complained about with the previous Toyotas, I believe it was the second gen Toyotas, is that they had some rust issues on the chassis. And I haven't noticed that at all. I mean, they have this trim here. They got plastic trim, so you're never gonna have to worry about, you know, that unsightly rusting around the wheel well. And they have other protective trim and liners around the critical parts that are rust prone. So, you know, I think they've taken the feedback that they've received from customers in the past and they've integrated that into this third generation Tacoma, which is now in its third year of production. So it started in 2016, then there was 2017, 2018. In terms of the interior, you got all your bells and whistles. I mean, I'm not really going to walk you through that, but you get your GPS, you get your on-screen touchscreen interface, satellite radio, all that stuff. So it's pretty slick, actually. There's, you know, it tells you lots of different information about the vehicle, how much tire pressure you got, what needs to be fixed on the vehicle. It has a keyless entry, which I wasn't too a big fan of. And, you know, if you have a keyless fob, they say you're supposed to keep it in a Faraday bag when you're in your house because they can, modern day thieves can use these amplification systems, which amplify the signal of your key fob, and they can start your car even though they don't have the key fob close, like near field communication that this relies on. They can amplify that signal. If the key is just sitting on your counter in your house, say your car's out in the driveway, one guy goes, puts up his amplifier, and that takes that signal, sends it to the truck, starts the truck, and then they're off. Now they can't start the truck again after they've had it going, but, or maybe they can, I don't know, but they can hack it again, or maybe once they get the signal, they can copy it or something like that. But so that's something to keep in mind, is that this is a keyless entry vehicle. And unfortunately, that's the way vehicles are going. It doesn't really give you a lot of power in terms of being able to fix it. It's not as mechanical, of course, it's more digital. So it's more prone to things like EMP for sure. So it's not a very EMP resistant vehicle, but as I'm gonna be talking about in this upcoming EMP video, only, according to the experts, only 5 to 10% of vehicles are actually gonna be severely impacted and immobilized in an actual, you know, high altitude nuclear EMP scenario. But that's clearly enough to cause a lot of chaos. And I'm gonna talk about that a bit more. but I'm not sure if they're factoring in new things like that, like the keyless entry, because with the keyless entry and the keyless start, the push button start, that's a pretty critical component of the system. And that could be, you know, in the case of an EMP, that could be one of those circuits that gets fried and pumped full of that electromagnetic radiation. So something to consider there. If you wanted something a bit more rustic, you may want to consider something else, because I'm pretty sure that's something that's across the board in Toyota vehicles now, but I could be wrong about that. What else can I say about it? In terms of the power, it's got 270 horsepower, I believe. It's a 3.5 liter engine. So it's not the most powerful engine. I mean, it's got a little bit of zip to it. If you turn on this function, which they call it ECT power. I can't remember exactly what that stands for, but that'll give you a bit more zip. The four-wheel drive is easy to activate. It's just a quick turn of a dial and it activates. So very easy to use that. I've put this truck to the test. Like I said, I've taken it into some pretty deep snow scenarios. I've taken it way, way out into the backwoods, you know, into places that I probably well could have gotten stuck and would have had to get towed out of, and it didn't get stuck. So, you know, I can't say enough good things about the truck. It's pretty long, so turning it around in a very small trail can be challenging, but it has the rear backup camera, which is very nice, but I don't fully rely on that either. I try to use my mirrors as much as possible just to keep my senses and my reflexes, you know, tuned to that. And but it is very functional, that rear view camera. It's amazing, the technology. It does have sensors, indicators to tell you if somebody's in your blind spot. So that's pretty useful, and it's a very accurate feature. I'm just amazed at how accurate it is. Like if I'm backing up, it'll tell me if there's a person walking their dog like 10 feet away. It's pretty fascinating. Now the newer ones, I believe they have the 360 camera, so they can actually tell you what's going on around your entire vehicle. So that's pretty nice. I did change the tires. I put some KO2 BF Goodrich tires on there. I was going to go with the DuraTrack, but these ones actually have thicker sidewalls, so they're 20% thicker sidewalls. So I went with that just because, you know, I am going down rocky terrain quite often, and going down the narrow roads that I do, sometimes, you know, you're rubbing up against stones on the side. So I wanted that sidewall protection on there, and really thick, really aggressive tread. So that was pretty cool. These are the rims that come with the sports version. I think the rims look a little bit better. I don't care about rims. I don't care about cosmetic stuffs and non-functional hood scoops. I could care less about that. I just wanted the Tacoma truck. The sunroof is kind of nice, but then again, you know, I don't really need it at all. It's something I would much sooner replace with a skid plate, to tell you the truth. The trunk, there's a 400 watt AC outlet in the back, which is kind of neat. There is a dampener on the tailgate, so when you open it, it opens very slowly. It's pretty cool actually, and it's gonna save your tailgate for sure. Like I say, I've loaded all kinds of stuff, logs, bricks, furniture, you know, things of that nature, and it's great to use. I've even loaded quads up there on a few occasions. So, you know, it works really well. In terms of the interior, it's not the most spacious interior. In fact, when you get into it, it does feel a little bit cramped up, especially if you're a taller person. You may not want to consider this. Now, as far as prepping vehicles go, I don't think this is the ideal prepper's truck. I mean, it is from a practical standpoint, but if you're talking about grid down, where you want to be able to utilize fuels which might be in greater abundance, like diesel fuel or something of that nature, something which can run on alternative fuel sources, then this might not be the truck for you. You may be able to modify it for that, but beyond changing tires and oil changes, possibly brakes, I really don't know enough about cars to go and do that myself. And unfortunately, I don't have the time to learn, but yeah, who knows, maybe you can make one of these things run on vegetable oil. I don't know, it's possible. Anything's possible, I guess. But in terms of practicality, yeah, it's really practical. Great four-wheel drive. It's gonna get you anywhere you need to go. It's gonna be reliable. It's going to last you a long time without having to get any serious maintenance done, like most Japanese vehicles are. The main thing is it's going to take care of you. It's going to get you where you need to go. When you're talking about some of these fringe organizations causing a ruckus in the Middle East, a lot of them are relying on Toyota vehicles because they're the ones that are, you know, the toughest. Now, I don't know if these new generation ones are built as tough as those older ones. You know, just like the Jeep has kind of gone downhill. It's become more of a commuter vehicle than a sport vehicle. But, you know, I think the essence of it is still there for the most part. It's just the body is a little softer. I've got a lot of scratches, a lot of nicks and cuts on this. You might not be able to see it with this lighting and stuff, but when you go look up close, there's a lot of scratches on this thing. Would I buy it again? I would buy a Toyota again in a heartbeat. In fact, I will be buying a Toyota again, but I might be stepping up to the Tundra. I know a lot of people don't like the Tundra compared to, you know, something like a, I don't know, like a Ford Raptor or a Dodge Ram or something of that nature, which is a bit more, you know, heavy duty. Some people have described it as being a little too plasticky for their liking. I don't really know what they mean by that, because really all cars are made of that same material nowadays anyways. But I'd absolutely buy one again. If they could make one with a slightly wider truck bed, that would be awesome. The only problem with this Diamondback cover is that I haven't found an optimal auxiliary fuel tank yet that I could add in the truck bed, because this thing only has 77 liters of fuel storage on board, which is just not enough for my liking. I would like to at least bring that up to about 150 liters of fuel on board, so that I could, if I had to travel a great distance at a moment's notice, I could. And I always try to keep the tank above half tank. It doesn't always end up that way, but you know, that's one piece of advice for you right there. Always have your gas at least over half a tank, as much as you possibly can, because you never know when the fuel trucks are gonna stop rolling, and the last thing you wanna do is stand in line, you know, for days and days to try to get gasoline and all the fights that are gonna ensue in that environment. So store as much gas on your person as you can legally. The best place to legally store it is in a vehicle. So once again, if you have any questions in the comments, I'm not a Toyota or mechanic or automotive expert by any stretch of the imagination, but I'll do my best to answer based on my own personal experience with the vehicle. And if you want more information about the Diamondback truck covers, I'll post a link in the description, and I'll probably post a few videos in the cards of that here. They're gonna actually be sending me another one for review. It's a newer one, which has had some new enhancements. So I'm really looking forward to share that with you as well. So thanks for watching. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe. Canadian Prepper out.